These breathtaking shots symbolize the majestic nature of the United States. Each designates a place of unique beauty, a place worthy of protection. Our national parks and national forests have astonished people for more than a century, inspiring politicians, explorers, writers, composers, and artists who have painted the wilderness on the canvas of the United States. This masterpiece would not exist without the efforts of one man, Theodore Roosevelt. Theodore Roosevelt empowered the early conservation movement, making the idea of land management essential to America's progressive future. The incredible industrial growth of the United States in the 19th century rapidly consumed its natural resources, such as wood, coal, and minerals. As the frontier closed in 1890, both citizens and politicians saw the West as an unlimited resource. Farmers used the land freely, hunters shot large game and birds at will, and lumber companies depleted the nation's forests quickly to satisfy America's voracious appetite for wood. John Wesley Powell was deeply disturbed by the spreading environmental destruction. As a geological surveyor, he educated members of Congress on the importance of the natural cycles of the land, but lost his position when congressmen found his ideas too radical. On the front lines of the environmental fight, John Muir created the Sierra Club, which fought for the protection of western areas. Muir pushed for the complete preservation of the natural resources, arguing that they should not be used. Gifford Pinchot, the first forester of the United States, fought for conservation, efficient use of the land. He argued that conservation stood for the greatest good for the greatest number over the longest time, establishing the need for sustainable resource management. With Powell, Muir, and Pinchot, the environmental movement got underway, but it needed a leader, a political ally, to help fulfill the greatest good. That person was Theodore Roosevelt. Theodore Roosevelt, who became president when McKinley was assassinated in 1901, emerged as the leader the conservation movement needed. For Roosevelt, there was no higher calling than the conservation that served the citizenry.
"For the people," he said, "must always include the people unborn as well as the people now alive when the democratic ideal is not realized."
It was imperative that enough resources were used to support the needs of the day, as well as to leave enough resources for future generations. And by doing this, Roosevelt ensured that the land passed down would be usable for the people unborn. Roosevelt organized his conservation plan into three elements: water conservation, wildlife protection, and forest conservation. The policy in the United States was, up until Roosevelt's time, to harvest the land and farm it, and then move on, rather than stay and make the land sustainable for many years with irrigation. Thus, huge amounts of land were left in a miserable state, cut over, arid, or unusable. Roosevelt's solution was to pass the Newlands Reclamation Act of 1902, and later, in 1907, the Inland Waterways Commission. The Newlands Reclamation Act aimed to reclaim the barren, unusable land for farming, while the Inland Waterways Commission studied the various connections waterways had with the surrounding resources, such as forests, soils, farms, wildlife, and other ecological factors. One of the products of the Newlands Reclamation Act was the creation of the 350-foot-high Roosevelt Dam, creating, from the waters of the Arizona Salt River, the Roosevelt Reservoir, currently one of the largest artificial bodies of water in the world. The reservoir served as the primary source of water for irrigation in the arid, seemingly useless land of Arizona. Farmers benefited from this reservoir and began to reuse the land, rather than moving on to new fields. The practice of irrigation is common in today's farming community, creating sustainable farmsteads. The second part of Roosevelt's conservation plan focused on preserving the animal populations of the country. Prior to Roosevelt, no other president had paid attention to wildlife. The first national bird reservation was created at Pelican Island, Florida, in 1903. Today, there are 535 wildlife refuges and over 3,000 bird sanctuaries in the United States. The last part of Roosevelt's conservation program addressed the nation's forests. The original forest cover in the United States numbered nearly 1 billion acres, which is one half the land area of the country. By the late 19th century, only half of the forests still existed. because trees were used for almost everything in the society of the time. From roads and bridges, to fuel and homes, to constructing whole cities, the logging industry had tremendous political power. Every person relied on the use of trees in everyday life. Due to this resource's vital role in society, Roosevelt had a daunting task: conserving those trees and ensuring the forests lasted for generations. Pinchot advocated that the forests needed to be managed wisely, by a competent organization that allowed for the regulated use of the forests, while also allowing the forests to exist in a natural state. Under the Transfer Act of 1905, Roosevelt heeded Pinchot's advice and established the Forest Service in the Department of Agriculture, because, he believed, the Department of Interior had a legacy of giving land away, not managing it. An example of the Forest Service ingenuity exists in Nebraska, and is known as the Nebraska National Forest, the largest man-made forest in the world. Countless other examples can be seen around the country. Along with the regulation of large tracts of land and numerous conservation bills passed, Roosevelt started an education program to increase awareness for conservation. Through speeches, lectures, journals, and newspapers, Roosevelt aligned with other conservationists, passing down the ideals of conservation. This educational movement did two things. It instilled in the average American the sense that the wilderness was a wonderful place worth saving, and it also gave business leaders more cause for anti-conservation measures. Many business leaders were alarmed that Roosevelt was not freely handing out the country's natural resources. Business leaders and politicians, frustrated with Roosevelt's conservation, formed the Denver Public Lands Convention in 1907 to protest his actions through the Fulton Amendment to the Agricultural Bill. Oregon Senator Fulton's amendment specifically forbade Roosevelt to set aside more land for forest reserves in five western states. Roosevelt had to sign the amendment or risk losing the entire agricultural bill. During the 10-day period a president has to sign or veto a bill, Roosevelt and Pinchot worked around the clock setting aside 21 new national forests totaling 16 million acres. These forests were nicknamed the Midnight Forests. Roosevelt, most likely with a chuckle, then signed the Fulton Amendment. Roosevelt's legacy is impressive. He created five national parks: Crater Lake, Wind Cave, Platte, Sully Hill, and Mesa Verde. Four huge game reserves were set aside in Oklahoma, Arizona, Montana, and Washington, as well as the National Bison Range, also located in Montana. 150 million acres of national forest land were set aside, an average of 55,000 acres a day during Roosevelt's presidency. The total land set aside by Roosevelt for regulated use came to 235 million acres of land, more than twice the size of California. None would exist without the political and moral stance of Theodore Roosevelt at the turn of the century. While he stood up to many influential groups regarding conservation, Roosevelt more importantly took a stand against the ignorant assumption that the nation's natural resources were limitless. His ideas about conservation prevented the mass depletion of natural resources that would have proven devastating during the drought of the 1930s, and that would have severely limited the accomplishments our country has made to this day. In examining our modern conservation issues such as habitat loss, climate change, and the oil problem, our world should look back to Theodore Roosevelt's conservationism to overcome these problems. The solutions to current problems are being investigated by such people and groups as Jane Goodall, Peter Pinchot, the World Wildlife Fund, the Quivira Coalition, and Roosevelt's descendants, who are following in the footsteps of President Theodore Roosevelt. As the human role in the environment continues to evolve, figures have emerged and argue, as did Roosevelt, that we are obligated to hand down a better world to our children. That requires strength and courage. And as Theodore Roosevelt once said,
"Far better it is to dare mighty things, to win glorious triumphs, even though checkered by failure, than to take rank with those poor spirits who neither enjoy much nor suffer much, because they live in the gray twilight that knows neither victory nor defeat."